Welcome to In the Spotlight. I'm Shirley Lin. Now, I'm really excited today to be speaking with Xuan Liu, Liu Xuan, who is, he's a writer, he's a DJ, he's a father of two kids, and he's a public speaker, he's also a radio host, and what else am I missing? I don't know. But I can't wait to meet him. So, hi, Xuan.
Hello, Shirley.
Good to meet you.
It's good to meet you, finally.
Yes, and you know, having heard so much about you, and of course today we're really going to talk about your book, but that would be for the second half of the interview. But to start off, why don't you tell a story that has impacted you?
Okay, well, this came as sort of a pop quiz right before the camera started rolling.
Oh, I told you that you were going to tell a story.
Okay. Well, okay, so my story is not about me.
Okay.
It's about a math genius. His name is Andy Hildebrand. And he studied musical theory and mathematics. And when he graduated from college, he worked for Exxon, the petroleum company.
Oil
company. And what he did was he worked in the research division, developing a way to interpret sonic data from the Earth. So what they would do is they would send vibrations into the Earth. And because sound waves travels at different speeds through different types of rock, so by judging the types of waves that come back, you can get a picture of what the Earth is like under you.
Right, and where if there's
oil. And where potential oil fields
are. Yeah, right.
Right. And so he was very successful at doing this, and he came up with a few new theories for based on this kind of special kind of mathematical model called autocorrelation. Now, I'm not a math genius, so I don't know anything about that.
It's another
name. So anyway, this made Exxon and him very rich, and so he retired early. And so when he retired, he thought, well, what am I going to do? He's always been interested in music. He's actually a flutist.
Yeah.
So he thought about maybe, he'll play some jazz flute, start up a band. And then he thought, well, maybe is there some way that I could apply my math training to music and bridge the two fields? And so he started working on that. And this was in the era when computers were just getting fast enough to start doing the real-time digital signal processing, right?
Okay.
So he worked on it for many years, and he came up with some cool stuff, but nothing groundbreaking. And then there was one day that he was having dinner with some friends, and the wife of one of his friends sat at the dinner table, and he said, oh, so you work with, doing fancy stuff with sound. If you can invent something that will keep me in key while I'm singing, then I would be ever so grateful.
Right.
Right. So this was meant as a joke.
Yeah.
Everybody thinks it's impossible. So everyone laughed it off, except Andy Hildebrand. After dinner, he thought about it, and he thinks, wait a second, there's actually something about the way that a person sings and autocorrelation that can be applied to that. So he did a lot of research, and then he eventually came up with the way to fix your pitch in real time. So as you're singing, if you're off key.
In real time?
In real time, yes.
Okay.
Yeah, and this was amazing. This came out as, it first came out as a plugin, as a software that hooks onto the digital audio workstations that people were recording on. And this product is called Auto-Tune, right?
Yes.
Auto-Tune.
I know I should go wow, but I'm sorry.
Well, you know what? You haven't heard the name,
right?
But you have definitely heard Auto-Tune in action. I guarantee you. Because it's on 99.9% of the records out there, especially any pop records, hit singles, you name it. All right, everyone uses it. Everyone uses it to sort of tweak their voice so that when they're a little bit fluctuating off key, it'll be pulled onto key and it will sound natural. All right.
Yeah. Well, you said real time. So what are you saying? When someone's having a concert right there and then, and the person that's doing the console,
Yes, it's actually available in a rack mount form in hardware.
Uh-huh.
So there's actually a lot of really, really top singers. I won't name who, but
no, don't.
Pretty much, there's a lot of people out there
okay. That
will not be able to go on tour without this thing. And when they're, dancing around on stage, when they sing, they're a slight bit off key. Of course, you have to, tell the computer which key you're in, right? But it will pull you to the nearest note of that key. So you will sound always perfectly in tune.
Yeah.
And you can adjust exactly how relaxed or how strict it is, right?
Uh-huh.
So the thing is that there's a setting that's really extreme. so that it works really fast, and it works just like almost like a robot, right? It'll pull you to like the perfect pitch. But the problem is that most people sound unnatural, because it's actually, you know, a good performance is actually supposed to waver a little bit. So when you tune it to, you know, the extreme, then you have this kind of robotic sound where when you're jumping between the keys, it actually has more, it goes like right angles instead of sort of pitch bending up to it, right? Uh-huh. And actually there's a bunch of people that started using it, like producers thought, well, you know what, it sounds totally unnatural, but it's really cool. So I think the first big single that they used auto-tune to that effect was Cher's Believe.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I don't know if you know that song.
I know Cher.
Cher, and there's Do You Believe in Love After All? Okay. And during the chorus, I'm not going to sing it because I don't have auto-tune here.
No.
But during the chorus, it goes into this really, really weird kind of sound. And back then, no one's heard it before. So they're like, wow, this is so new. Mm-hmm. It became this, you know, the I think probably the top one single in, I think, 1999 or 2000 or whatever it is. And then there were a bunch of artists that started using it, you know, to death, like T-Pain, a lot of the Girls' Generation, a lot of the Korean artists, artists. Whenever they go into the chorus and you start hearing these kind of like really sort of right, very angular, robotic pitch changes, that's auto-tune.
Oh.
And then when you are not hearing it, when it sounds all natural, that's auto-tune also.
Okay.
So basically, there are so
this
many
really
artists
smart,
out there.
Right? It's just totally smart.
Well, it's smart, and it's also, it also obviously made Andy Hildebrand even more wealthy.
Yeah.
Right? And also launched the careers of many artists who otherwise would not have been able to be artists.
Including you? Because this story has made an impact on you? Not a singer.
Well, you know what? The way that this story made an impact on me is two things. One is Andy Hildebrand, he bridged two different fields, music and, you know, seismology, basically. And he created something totally new because he worked in both of these fields. And very few people are musicians and they study the earth. And he was able to do that and created this product that had nothing to do with either one of them, but actually helped a lot of people.
Right.
And the second thing is that a lot of times something that we take for granted, like a dinner table conversation, you know, hey, make me sing on key. You know, hey, to us it's a joke, but to someone whose mind is well prepared, mm-hmm. and who comes from the right background, he gets that and this inspiration, and it launches something which we call a lucky break.
Mm. Of course, you're talking a lot of things about your book, but we're going to get to that later. Okay, the book is called Get Lucky, 祝你好运. So basically, get lucky. That's the English translation, right?
Well, a lot of my English-speaking friends are like, do you mean like get lucky, isn't that get lucky? Like, well, it's a little bit intentional, the double entendre, you know?
Uh-huh, okay. But I think you didn't intend to be a writer because your dad was a writer, mm-hmm. but you didn't think that you were going to be, you know, walking his steps until much later, right? I mean, what was the very first
Not
interest?
Even until much later.
Oh,
it was
well,
like
not
ever.
That much later.
Probably.
Right.
Yeah.
So, right, ever. Okay. So, was it like intentionally, like you just didn't want to walk in your dad's footsteps? And by the way, your dad's Liu Yong, who is a very famous writer. And also, actually, he also hosts a TV show. Mm-hmm. But he's a very smart guy, according to your mom. And probably you think so, too. But I think a lot of young people here respect your dad a lot, and that probably puts a little bit of pressure on you. But now you're getting to be who you are, regardless of your dad or who your dad is. But anyway, okay. So what's my question? What was the first thing that you started off as your interest? I mean, you studied at Harvard, and that was in what field?
It was psychology.
Psychology, and that's why you have the book. We're gonna get to that, like I said. So. What was the very first interest?
You know how they always ask kids in the States, like, what do you want to be when you grow up? And everyone always had an answer.
You didn't have an answer.
I never had an answer. Because my answer would always be, I don't want to grow up. Why do I want to grow up? You know, growing up is hard. I see the adults around me, they're working their butts off. You know, I can enjoy being me. And so all I really wanted to be was a kid. And I think it was also partly is... I felt that I didn't exactly know what I wanted to do. You know, I wasn't someone who had life like calling me
right.
you know, from a very early age. I had life happen to me. And a lot of big changes happened in my life. You know, when I was born, our family was not well off.
Right.
We lived on the side of train tracks. Mm-hmm. I was born in Taipei, and it's by a place called Huashan, the Huashan Cultural Park now.
Yeah, actually. Now.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And so the train tracks are now Civic Boulevard, Simindadao, mm-hmm. right? And I lived right next to it. So every day I would watch the trains pass. So I was like a very early train spotter. And then, but you know, I was a happy kid, you know, according to my parents. And then at that time, my dad wrote a book, kind of, it was also almost kind of by accident because he's actually a painter by trade and by training.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's a classical Chinese painter of watercolors. And he, because he was hosting a TV show at the time, so he wrote some scripts for it that are more motivational. He thought maybe I could publish this. And no
to
one
go
wanted
with
to
his
publish
painting?
It. To,
he was like...
No, actually, because of the show. Because of the show.
Oh,
so
all
he
right.
thought he had a chance. But actually, all the publishing companies told him, like, no, we're not interested. So he just, you know, he printed a few hundred copies himself. But then they just ended up becoming a bestseller.
Right.
Yeah, totally by accident.
Yes.
And so that changed our life. When I was 5 years old, we were able to move out of that little, it's kind of a, it was, a, you know, 违章建筑. It wasn't even supposed to be
illegal
built
building.
In there. Yeah, yeah,
okay.
yeah. And then moved to 忠孝东路四段. Now,
all right.
Which is, yeah, 忠孝 section 4, which now everyone
downtown
knows
Taipei.
Is a very expensive area. And back
yeah.
then it was just starting to get developed.
Yep.
Right. So that was the first big change. And then my father got an opportunity to become an artist in residence at the Danville Museum in Virginia.
Right.
And it was a part of a kind of an artist exchange program they were having okay. with the National History Museum here. And so he took it.
Uh-huh.
You know, he quit his job, you know, a very nice job at the television station. Mm-hmm. And he just, you know, picked up and he just left. And so between the ages of 5 and 8, I didn't see my dad. He just left, you know, the whole family. Apparently this was a very common thing to do. Back then, you know, for a
really?
Lot of yeah, for a lot of men, you see this actually happening in mainland China right now.
That
where,
is true.
Wherever the opportunity is, you
yeah.
know, you have kids, you leave them behind. You go and you find opportunity, you make something of yourself, and then you take the family over when you're ready. Right?
But it seems so, like your dad was so lucky to have that opportunity just out of nowhere, sort of. Isn't
which one?
I
you
mean,
mean the,
I mean, to
the artist?
Yeah.
And,
yeah
well,
Virginia?
Actually, you know, he fought very hard for it. Because as a painter, you know, he has always worked very hard at his painting. He won a lot of national competitions.
Oh.
And so that got him that opportunity. So it was step by step. It didn't just fall out of thin air.
So he was first a painter, then a writer.
Yes. He was first a painter and is a writer by accident.
Yeah.
Yeah. And but he always loved words.
He seemed always very optimistic about life.
You know what? No, I wouldn't say that he was optimistic. No, no.
Okay.
I would say that he is a pragmatist and also that he's that he has a very high degree of self-efficacy where he feels that, you know, whatever obstacles come my way is a problem to be solved rather than, you know, rather than a setback.
Of course, you mentioned that in your book, too.
And yeah, that's a crucial factor on having
a lucky life. Are you a pragmatist, too, you think?
I try to be. I don't think as much as he is, because he's a self-made man. So I think a lot of self-made men have, I think just by virtue of them being self-made, have a high degree of self-efficacy.
Mm.
So, but all I know is when I was 8 years old, I was plucked out of my comfortable environment in Dongqu and then put right into the States.
Yeah.
And basically, you know, I wasn't prepared for it at all.
Not even the language.
Not even the language. Yeah. My ABCs, I probably knew up to D and then I couldn't even recite the alphabet. Seriously.
Okay.
Like my English was terrible. And so I went there and then within 2 weeks of getting there, they put me into a private Catholic school just because it's close to our house. And also because they think it's be less likely for me to get beat up after school for being such
yes.
an FOB, like fresh off the boat.
Uh-huh.
Right. So I went there. There was no ESL program. So I literally
oh,
was
not
a sink
in those
or swim.
Days.
Yeah. And so the first day of school, I sunk. I sunk terribly. The teachers didn't know how to speak Chinese. They were looking at me and handing me a piece of paper and a pencil. And they just said, copy onto the blackboard. And I didn't even know how to read what's on the blackboard. I mean, there was like hieroglyphics to me.
Yeah.
So I just sketched the blackboard. And they realized that, wait a second, this kid really doesn't know anything. They asked me, the classmates asked me, so what's your name?
Right.
And I couldn't understand, their question. So I answered them in the only phrase that I knew how to say, which was, I don't know. So guess what my name was, you know, all the way until graduation.
Know.
Yeah, that was it. So it was, you know, it was very tough in the first day. And then the teachers realized, wait a second, we can't deal with this kid. So they had me put back into second grade. So I was left back after one day of school.
Oh, just one day.
Just one day of school. Yeah, they think that it would be a little bit easier for me. And so that's how my adventures in life, you know, really sort of got started. These two big changes when I was 5 and then when I was 8,
mm-hmm.
moving to the States.
Wow.
And it was totally fish out of water.
All right.
Yeah. So you asked me what I wanted to be after having that happen to me. I just wanted to be a kid. I just want to fit in. I just want to be happy. You know, I just want to have friends that would stick around, you know, and for me not having to suddenly move somewhere else,
yeah.
which ended up doing also in New York if we moved twice.
Mm,
yeah.
All right. Well, we're going to hear more about Xuan's life story. You know, maybe his childlike character made him who he is today, a man of all trades. No, a jack of all trades and also a man of all hats. I mean, wearing lots of hats. Okay, so we're going to talk about that later on. So let's take a break here.